Mike Tyson interview.
The truth of the matter of what happened that night then as well.
That she was not raped.
An Ed Bradley exclusive. Street Stories returns Thursday.
Something new is coming to CBS, filled with intrigue, suspense, and danger. Lee Horsley investigates Bodies of Evidence, premiering Thursday.
What was the most expensive film ever made? If you said Terminator 2, you're right. What New England town's the setting for Murder, She Wrote? If you answered Cabot Cove, you're ready to play the ultimate movie TV trivia game. Join host Bob Goen for the premiere of The Hollywood Game, Friday at 8, 7 Central on CBS.
This is CBS.
Choosing the best answering machine is now a simple process of elimination. Introducing call answering from New England Telephone. It picks up where answering machines leave off. Nothing to fix or clutter the house. All you need is your phone. To order, call 1-800-499-5200. We're the one for you, New England. New England Telephone. Part of the Ninex family.
This is my field of dreams, Foxborough Stadium. In my first year as a head coach, the front office said to me, give us a winning team and they will come. This year, I have something else to add. Give them a great way to get here and more will come.
Now you can own a Geo Prism for as low as $85.90 or a Geo Storm for only $97.75 thanks to Chevy Cashback.
Drive a dream, only stay off of my field. Thank you.
See your neighborhood Chevrolet Geo dealer today.
Yeltsin vows to unravel the POW mystery at 11.
Always give your best. Never get discouraged. Never be petty. Always remember, others may hate you. But those who hate you don't win unless you hate them. And then you destroy yourself.
This is a hell of a government. And this country's lived through a lot of bad things. It's lived through some presidents that weren't quite up to par. And it's lived through some conditions that you and I can remember. They weren't good, but we've lived through them.
I don't think the public ever really understood the real sin, the crime, the import of Watergate.
This was third world dictatorship. This was lawlessness. This was above the law and beyond reproach. These were people who had satisfied themselves that they could not be touched.
20 years ago, on June 17, 1972, in the dead of night, a group of men working for the committee to re-elect Richard Nixon president broke into the offices of the Democratic National Committee here at the Watergate office complex.
So began not only the greatest political scandal of our time, but one of the great detective stories, too. From that day to this, much of what has come to be known as Watergate remains a mystery. What were the burglars really after across the street? Who started the cover-up? What did the FBI know and when? And who is Deep Throat, that mysterious individual who leaked precious information about the president's men, information that helped cause Richard Nixon's downfall?
Tonight, we shall try to answer those questions. For those of you who remember Watergate, we shall offer some new information that may surprise you. For those of you who know nothing about Watergate, what follows is a story of power and corruption in this country, the power of a president to break the law, and the power of the people and the press to do something about it. It could happen again just as surely as it did 20 years ago. No one imagined then that what has been called a third-rate burglary could ever lead to the downfall of the President of the United States. The lead burglar was James McCord, a former agent for the CIA. The ringleaders were Gordon Liddy, a former FBI agent, and Howard Hunt, also former CIA.
Our command post, as it were, was in a room in the Watergate Hotel, which is a building adjacent to the Watergate office complex. And it was from there that the four Cubans and Jim McCord left to go into the Watergate office building.
The first indication that there might have been some break-in came about when a guard came down and saw that there was tape on the door. He had remembered that carpenters or other workers had been in the building earlier that day, and he thought they put it on. So he removed the tape. McCord, who was the one who put the tape on, going out on one occasion, sees the tape's removed, and he runs back and he calls Liddy. And he says, they found us out. The tape's been removed.
And at that point, I said, let's scratch it. And Liddy objected, let's go. Everybody's here. We got the team assembled. They've all come up from Miami. McCord's here. Go. So they went, filed off into history.
Early morning, June 17th, 1972, 20 years ago, you're at home asleep.
The phone rings, and it's the city editor at the Post saying there's been a burglary at the Democratic headquarters. Could I come in? It's Saturday. I'm not scheduled to work. I like to salute. So I did.
Woodward was a very favored character of the city editor. He hadn't been to work at the Washington Post for very long.
Nine months,
I believe. He was not very well liked by his colleagues, including me.
Why? What was wrong with Woodward?
Obviously. Well, I think I unfairly had the view of him as this kind of Ivy League, privileged, not very hard-working, didn't really know enough pavement. He'd been an officer in the Navy. I'm a street kid. So I didn't think he was as good as maybe some of the editors did.
Woodward had developed a knack of getting into the paper. I mean, you'd send him into the most remote corner of some damn suburb, and Woodward come back with a page one story, and it was checked out. Bernstein's his reputation was slightly more eccentric than that, but he was... He knew the score. He was a streetwise kid.
And I heard what had happened. I told the city editor that I'd like to make some calls because I was kind of known as being okay at using the phones. I called the Watergate, started talking to Bellman, started talking to desk clerks, started finding out a little bit about these guys.
And the mystery kept compounding itself. Five burglars, business suits, rubber gloves, $100 bills in their pockets. Sophisticated photographic equipment. James McCord turned out to be the head of the burglary team. The judge asked him, are you employed? And McCord whispered that he had worked or did work at the CIA.
So immediately you say?
Not your average burglar.
It's remarkable that 20 years after the Watergate break-in, there are still questions about why the burglary occurred. What were they looking for? Part of the confusion stems from the little-known fact that there were two break-ins. The first was actually undetected. But when the burglars discovered that one of the wiretaps they'd planted wasn't working, they went in a second time to make sure they could listen to the conversation of the Democratic National Chairman. There have been some new theories about why the break-in occurred, the latest being that it was to retrieve evidence of a call girl ring that would embarrass White House counsel John Dean. Not so, says Al Baldwin, who should know, for he was part of the burglary team, and his job was to monitor the wiretaps. He listened to over 200 conversations.
I have been asked the question with respect to whether or not any type of call ring or prostitution-type ring was operating out of the Democratic National Headquarters, and I can categorically state from the conversations that were obtained that no such operation was being conducted, at least from the conversations that I was monitoring.
The FBI reports show no evidence of a call girl ring. Agent Daniel Mahan, who spent 3 years investigating the entire operation, says the break-in was politics, pure and simple.
I think the paranoia of the White House and Republicans at that time was to such a
a level that they were afraid that Mr. Nixon would be defeated that coming fall. And they were looking for anything and everything they could do to facilitate his reelection. And that's the reason they were in there. That's the only reason they were in there.
So too says Howard Hunt, who adds this important detail about the burglary.
The account books of the Democratic National Committee, which were theoretically kept in the offices of Larry O'Brien, who was then the DNC chairman, could conceivably reflect the entry of foreign funds. And for that reason, we had been authorized to try to get photographs of these, the pages, in fact, all of the pages of the account books, and bring them back for future exploitation by the White House.
Who was it, and what was it that worried the White House most? That story when we continue.
On June 22nd, you'll meet a sedan that's not like everybody else's. Until then, you'll just have to wait, like everybody else. The all-new Mazda 626.
Healthy. A lot of foods are wearing that name. And yeah, they may have the numbers to back it up, but do they have a taste that'll make you want to eat them?
Now this is Healthy Favorite Smoked Turkey from Oscar Mayer. This is the real thing. Nothing funny. It's real turkey breast that's naturally low in fat and only 12 calories a slice.
And the taste? Well, the proof's right here.
New Healthy Favorites from Oscar Mayer. Who else would you trust?
During the Father's Day sale at JCPenney, you'll find all kinds of shirts for all kinds of dads. Shirts for buttoned-up dads at $18, and buttoned-down dads at 2 for $28. Shirts for solid dads at $19.99, and colorful dads at $15.99. You'll save on every shirt in stock during the JCPenney Father's Day sale, which is perfect for dads who wear their hearts on their sleeves.
Of all the things around your house that need batteries, there's one thing that needs a good, fresh battery most of all. See your Allstate agent for a free home fire safety brochure. And please check the battery in your smoke detector often.
They told her she couldn't do it.
Women aren't cut out for that kind of flying.
I'm just as good as anybody else.
But her dream was to conquer the sky.
I want to dance with the angels.
You are going to have to choose between our marriage and that aeroplane.
Valerie Bertinelli stars as a woman who broke all the rules and became a legend.
You have guts.
Based on the true story.
Never have I been so graceful.
Pancho Barnes at a special time, Saturday at 8.
The Mike Tyson interview.
What happened that night?
An Ed Bradley exclusive.
What do you say to the jury that convicted you? You think you got a fair shot?
First answers from prison.
What about the inmates? How are the inmates treated?
Mike Tyson talks when an all-new Street Stories returns Thursday at 9.
She witnessed her husband attack his mistress.
Killed her.
Now only a stranger with a secret can save her. Robert Urich, Marky Post, Stranger at My Door, Sunday. One's a reluctant hero, the other just reluctant.
Is this personal or is there cash involved?
Jeffrey Meek, Lee Majors.
I'm living here in Hawaii with Robin Hood.
Coming next Wednesday, Raven.
Tonight on CBS Late Night, Dangerous Curves.
There was a secret government. There was a secret attitude of hate that was directed at the press and the Democrats and the people who opposed the Vietnam War.
Hate?
Hate.
What destroyed the Nixon presidency didn't begin with a burglary in the late spring of 72. It began here at Richard Nixon's inaugural in the winter of 1969. His great triumph spoiled by anti-Vietnam War demonstrators.
Serve, protect, and defend.
The seeds for Watergate were planted on this day in a rage that would lead to a terrible end.
Inaugural day was, for a lot of us, a very exciting, thrilling day. But it was a tough day, too, because there were many people in the city that were protesting the war. They were visible to some people on the edge of the parade route, and it did set a fairly tense mood at the time that I think carried through for quite some time thereafter.
Covering the protest that day for the Washington Post was a young Carl Bernstein.
Watergate was basic to his presidency. It was not incidental. Watergate was intimately connected to his goals as president, which had to do with how the Vietnam War would be pursued and how we would get out of it. Really, Nixon's presidency always seemed to me to be about Nixon, his own aspirations, not the country.
Within 5 months, Richard Nixon would authorize wiretaps on men inside his own administration because he believed they were subverting his efforts in Vietnam. And from there, the dishonesty, the dirty tricks, the descent toward Watergate was inexorable. The protests became more intense. At one point, more than 100,000 anti-war demonstrators were marching toward Richard Nixon's White House, where troops from the 82nd Airborne were billeted in the basement.
It was a banana republic. It was a legitimate siege. And there was one weekend I couldn't go home, slept in my office, because it was too hard getting in and out of the White House. You had buses all around the White House, cordoned off, and a couple of the buses got turned over. And then the tear gas hit, and there was a west wind, and it swept across the White House.
And it wasn't just the anti-war movement that frightened the Nixon White House. There were the militant Black Panthers and the radical left, and leaks to the press that Nixon felt were sabotaging his foreign policy. And then, not just a leak, but a gusher. On June 13, 1971, the New York Times published the first part of a classified Defense Department study detailing the hidden history of the Vietnam War. Defense analyst Daniel Ellsberg had leaked what came to be known as the Pentagon Papers.
One of the decisive moments in the escalation of Watergate from resentment, paranoia, siege mentality to crossing the line.
Right.
Was a couple of meetings I was in when Nixon, in absolute frustration, and somewhat justifiable, in my opinion, was pounding the desk in the Oval Office saying, we've got to do something to stop these expletive deleted leaks. I want those classified documents protected.
And that's where the plumbers began.
That's where the plumbers started.
The plumbers, a secret organization put together by the White House to plug press leaks by any means necessary. Working for the plumbers were Howard Hunt and Gordon Liddy. The head plumber was Eagle Krogh.
Many things you look back and say, it's crazy. How could you have thought about these things? But you had to have almost been part of that and felt the intensity of it to see that we were to leave no stone unturned to try to find out why these things had happened.
Everyone was suspected of leaks. We have learned that the craziness even reached the point of tapping the phones of the President of the United States. But as far as we know, the President was unaware that his own phone had been bugged in this way. That from a former Nixon aide directly involved with the plumbers. In another bizarre move, the plumbers broke into the office of Daniel Ellsberg, psychiatrist, hoping to find that Ellsberg had a connection to a foreign government. But the burglary yielded nothing. The operation had been approved by John Ehrlichman, the third most powerful man in the White House.
And I think this was the beginning of a series of events that took place over the next 2 years that led to the downfall of that administration, because we stepped over the line for what we thought were good and sufficient reasons at the time. In retrospect, they were neither good nor were they sufficient. And it wasn't just a mistake, it was a serious crime.
It's important to remember that what ultimately led to the Watergate break-in was driven by presidential politics, by Richard Nixon's fear of losing.
Okay, hi.
By the spring of 1971, it was becoming clear that he could turn out to be a one-term president. His popularity had plunged to its lowest since his election. The Democrats smelled blood. Four of them declared for the presidency. But Senator Edmund Muskie of Maine was the clear front runner.
And I think that candidate is me.
McGovern was the candidate that, beginning in January, when I was tracking all the polls and would study the poll data daily, he was the one candidate that we wanted more than anything else, but never dreamt could ever get nominated.
Who was the guy that you feared?
Muskie. Muskie would have been a much more difficult candidate for Nixon to defeat.
The documentation of what they intended to do about Senator Muskie is clear. Mr. Pat Buchanan, back in March of 1971, wrote a memo to Mr. Nixon and said as follows: if Mr. Muskie is not cut and bleeding before he goes into New Hampshire, he will likely massively win there. Another memo from Mr. Buchanan to the president, and he said, who should we get to poke the sharp stick into the cage to bring Muskie howling forth? More important, what kind of stick is more effective?
Buchanan, then a Nixon speechwriter, denies any connection. But it was at that time that Donald Segretti received a call from a college friend who was working in the White House.
About 3 to 4 months before I was due to be released from the military, I got a call out of the blue.
From?
Dwight Chapin, working in the White House. They asked me if I wanted to work in the campaign for Richard Nixon, the 72 election campaign.
And what they really wanted you to do was?
Dirty tricks.
Dirty tricks. No two words are more synonymous with Watergate. And these dirty tricks began in the White House.
You have to go back and realize at the time how astonishing it was to learn that really reprehensible dirty tricks were financed by the president's personal attorney, that the guy doing it, Donald Segretti, had been recruited not by Howard Hunt or Gordon Liddy, but by Dwight Chapin, the president's appointment secretary.
We had the biggest fundraiser plan that we had ever put together. We were hoping to raise over $1 million and really enable us to continue in the race. We had it at the Washington Hilton. And what happened? Mr. Segretti, Mr. Chapin, and others determined to really disrupt that. And how'd they do it?
We ordered limousines in the name of the campaign. We invited foreign ambassadors to arrive as honored guests. We ordered pizza, chicken.
They sent thousands of flowers collect. And what was the result? Instead of dealing with the finance people that we had hoped to deal with, I was apologizing to ambassadors from the African states. I was arguing with the people who sent the hundreds of pizzas, saying, why has this occurred? I was worrying about all of those things instead of doing what we wanted to do.
You wrote some kind of a letter on Muskie stationery. Do you remember that one?
Yes. We mailed it to Jackson campaign headquarters, hoping that they would believe it came from one of the other candidates.
It was addressed to dear fellow Democrats. And you remember what it said, in effect?
Yes.
It was a letter widely disseminated accusing Senators Hubert Humphrey and Scoop Jackson of sexual and alcoholic misconduct.
It said that he had an illegitimate daughter named Mary Ann Kramer, born February 7th, 1929, etc., etc., etc.
It was totally fallacious. None of it was true.
And you were responsible for this?
I was involved in that, yes.
What it ended up with was pitting the Democratic candidates angrily against one another.
By late spring, Muskie was finished. And the Republicans got the opponent they wanted, George McGovern.
They destroyed the one centrist candidate who had the greatest possibility of beating President Nixon in the fall. What they had done was to destroy a candidate in another party to assure their own reelection. It, in my judgment, deprived the American people of a legitimate choice.
What do Woodward and Bernstein say about Deep Throat? We'll be back in a moment.
Luxury automobiles provide both driver and passenger side airbags. One of them is a Lincoln. And the other one is a Lincoln. With Lincoln,
it's easy to be on the safe side. Lincoln, what a luxury car should be. With Matchlight, you get the best charcoal, Kingsford. With just the right amount of lighter fluid. Already added. That's why there's only one match for Matchlight. Matchlight from Kingsford.
Boy, oh boy, are you gonna get it? You'll never believe what you're getting into. You can't escape, so you might as well forget it. Just wait till we get our hands on you.
Recycling's easy if you got the right stuff and you know what to do. So don't make a mess. Just ask Ace.
Ace Harmony trash bags are just $1.97, and Ace siliconized acrylic caulk is 88 cents a tube.
Ace Best Buys, another reason Ace is a place for you.
Hellman's Real Mayonnaise.
Bring out the praise.
Nothing can top it.
For the one best mayonnaise.
Nothing beats this taste.
Bring out the Hellman's.
America's favorite.
And bring out the best.
It's the one great secret in the whole world. It's really the only great secret that's lasted for 20 years. It's quite remarkable. We knew everything about the Russians. They knew everything about us. This is a real secret.
Who could possibly be Deep Throat? That answer coming up later.
All your money now!
Thursday, a robbery at gunpoint leads an off-duty officer on a desperate chase. An all-new story on Top Cops.
Friday, two gentlemen in their 70s are out to prove that life is worth living at any age.
He's in the pond.
With all the ups, all the downs.
You mean he's gone off his rocker, don't you?
Look at me.
And all the love. Emmy Award winners Hume Cronin and Vincent Gardenia are age-old friends Friday.
This is CBS.
There are three new things about Ford's F-Series trucks in 92. The outside, the inside, and the flare side, Ford's newest model, with a sportier look that comes in some hot new colors.
Now save $2,500 on the newly designed F-150 with all this equipment, plus a Ford bedliner.
The downside, this offer ends soon. So put yourself on the driver's side today.
Hurry to your New England Ford dealer.
When Hank Phillippe Ryan and the new seven investigators are on a case, watch out.
Nowhere to run, baby. Nowhere to hide. I got nowhere to run, baby. Nowhere to hide. Everywhere I go, your face I see.
For the best investigative reporting in Boston, keep your eye on News 7, the one to watch.
New indictments in the Seguin case. The story at 11.
The Watergate break-in really came from a series of meetings, believe it or not, and it's hard to believe even now, in the Attorney General's office, John Mitchell, chief law enforcement officer of the land, the deputy Nixon campaign manager, Jeb Magruder, the president's counsel, John Dean, and Gordon Liddy, kind of the operations manager of dirty tricks and intelligence gathering for the Nixon campaign. And there were three meetings in which Liddy outlined all of the intelligence gathering that's legal and illegal.
The lights on the eighth floor at the Watergate complex across the street here immediately were turned off.
In the early morning of June 17th, Al Baldwin's job was to act as lookout for the Watergate burglars.
Three individuals appeared on the sixth floor, the Democratic National Headquarters. These three individuals dressed in casual clothes, guns drawn. I immediately on the walkie-talkie said, well, we've got problems. Within moments, another communication comes over the walkie-talkie. They've got us.
About 4 o'clock that morning, I received a telephone call at home from my office saying there had been a burglary at the Watergate Apartments, and the police had been called. And I said, rather sleepily, why are you bothering me about that? That's not anything the FBI has jurisdiction over. That's a local burglary. Call the police. And he said, no, boss, it's a little different. He said they found some little round things with wires.
At the time, little was known of the FBI investigation and how much progress they had swiftly made. But now that the files have become available through the Freedom of Information Act, we know that the FBI was, in fact, gathering evidence with remarkable speed. And that had the White House in a panic.
By the end of the day, we had fully identified the 5 individuals who had been arrested because they had given fictitious names at the outset. We also determined that another individual was possibly involved, and that was Howard Hunt.
I have no comment.
Later that evening, in examining everything that had gone on that day, I raised the theory, what was the CIA doing, if anything, in the Democratic National Committee headquarters?
I decided right then and there to get in touch with Acting Director Gray of the FBI.
Richard Helms at the time was director of the CIA.
But that as far as the agency was concerned, we had nothing to do with this burglary or this operation. We knew nothing about it, and I wanted to assure him of that point. And then there was a week, or almost a week, of endless leaks of one sort and another. We didn't know whether they were coming from the Justice Department or the FBI or where they were coming from. But it seemed that there was almost a conspiracy to involve and entangle the CIA in this burglary. This bothered me a lot.
If Richard Helms could have seen the notes of Nixon's Chief of Staff, H.R. Haldeman, written just a day after the break-in, he would have better understood. For the White House was already trying to manipulate the Watergate story by making the break-in look like a CIA operation. Idea, it said, to get it as confused as possible and keep up the idea of McCord's other employment, CIA. In those same notes, he goes on to say, there's a real problem whether anything is traceable to Liddy. Most people think the White House cover-up began on June 20th, 3 days after the break-in, but we believe that these notes indicate the cover-up started just one day after the break-in, when Bob Haldeman was with the president down in Key Biscayne, Florida. On that same day, the White House phone logs show that the president made a call to his aide, Charles Colson.
I said to the president, it may be that there's some of these guys had ties to the committee to reelect the president. He, at that point, launched into a series of...
Wait a minute. Some of these guys who broke in...
Right.
...had ties to the CRP.
To the committee to reelect the president. Nixon said nobody in our operation could be that stupid. He said, that's the blankety-blank thing I've ever heard in my life. Was furious and said that he had smashed an ashtray when someone had told him that our people had something to do with it.
A day later, June 19th, Bob Woodward made a phone call to a friend who, he says, had a sensitive position in the executive branch. And his friend told him that Howard Hunt, who had an office in the White House, had been involved in the Watergate break-in. It was that friend, Woodward's secret source more than any other, that helped keep the investigation alive at the Washington Post. Around the newsroom there, that source was jokingly named after a porno film of the time, Deep Throat.
Great source. And what's interesting, if you go back and look at it, it's he helped, he steered, he was useful and in many ways, but he didn't know everything. And sometimes he was wrong.
You know who Deep Throat is.
I do.
Is he alive?
I don't answer any questions about it.
There was a single Deep Throat.
Mike, you didn't hear me. I do not answer questions about it.
It's the one great secret in the whole world. It's really the only great secret that's lasted for 20 years. It's quite remarkable. We knew everything about the Russians. They knew everything about us. This is a real secret.
One individual.
One individual.
Still alive.
Still alive.
Who just doesn't want to come forward.
That's correct.
What is the potential fallout to Deep Throat if he comes forward and says, look, I was the guy, I'll write the book, he can make a fortune, obviously, on the lecture circuit or whatever, if that interests him.
Great questions. I'm not answering.
You're going to sit there like the Sphinx.
Bob and I, have made arrangements that upon the death of the individual known as Deep Throat, that we indeed will make his identity public. And should we, as the term goes, predecease him, we've also made arrangements that his identity will become known.
Oh, I didn't get that from Bradley, and I didn't get that from Woodward.
No.
So it's one individual.
Absolutely.
Not a composite.
Absolutely.
Male, American.
What we wrote in the book is true. An individual who occupied a sensitive position in the executive branch of the government.
More about Deep Throat later. On June 23rd, 6 days after the break-in, Richard Nixon spent part of his day making a film for the upcoming Republican convention. This would turn out to be the most fateful day of his presidency.
Get up early.
You around?
Yes, sir. He's upstairs.
That morning, away from the cameras, Bob Haldeman received an urgent phone call from White House counsel John Dean. Notes from that conversation say, investigation out of control, Gray looking for a way out.
Dean and Haldeman were discussing the FBI, which by this time had traced the $100 bills found on the Watergate burglars to Mexico, and were about to trace that money back to Nixon's reelection committee. Again, from Haldeman's notes, call Walters in, have him talk to FBI Director Gray. After that phone call, Haldeman met with the president and then with the CIA Director Richard Helms and his second in command, Vernon Walters. At that meeting, Haldeman asked them to interfere with the FBI investigation.
And it was quite clear from the beginning of the meeting that there was a certain hostility going on here. They wanted Walters to go down to see the acting director, Gray, of the FBI, and to indicate to him that he should knock off, if you like, in an investigation in Mexico, because it might run into some of CIA's operations in Mexico.
In effect, the CIA was being told to block the FBI investigation. But this misuse of the CIA would prove to be the act that brought down Richard Nixon, for it was a blatant obstruction of justice. Nevertheless, FBI field agents were charging ahead. In July and August of 1972, they were quickly gathering evidence not only about the Watergate burglary, but also about political dirty tricks and possible campaign fund violations.
There were days when we would love to have stood out in a corner of 12th and Pennsylvania and announced what we had uncovered that day, but we were precluded from doing that. Federal law precluded us from speaking about what we learned and the people that we spoke to.
You wouldn't know that anything was amiss that summer. At their convention, the Republicans were treating Watergate as if it was a minor annoyance. But by this time, John Mitchell, Nixon's campaign manager, had already resigned, and the money trail was leading to a slush fund in the safe of Maurice Stans, treasurer for the committee to reelect.
Mr. Stans, it's nice to see you here once again.
Thank you, Mike. It's nice to be here.
Mr. Stans, there was some talk that you were going to resign your job as finance chairman. But now I understand that tomorrow morning, the Republican National Committee is going to confirm you as the finance chairman of the Republican National Committee.
Mike, that ought to be a pretty good signal that that nothing to do with all the matters that are being discussed.
In other words, the talk of cover committees down in Mexico, of money being funneled...
Oh, Mike, forget it. This, none of this has anything to do with me.
But it did. The disbursement of money from his safe, who gave it out, who received it, could lead to the higher-ups involved in the Watergate break-in.
I frankly have a better appreciation of it now than I did at the time. Mm-hmm. The lead from Deep Throat, follow the money. So important on this story. And we followed the money.
They followed it to a woman who worked for Stans and kept a list of the people getting money from Stans' safe. That woman, an unsung heroine of Watergate, was a bookkeeper named Judy Hoback. And for the first time, she's agreed to speak publicly.
One evening, after dark, there came a knock at the door,
and this young man was standing there, identified himself as a reporter with the Washington Post, and I immediately said, I don't want to speak to anybody. Before I knew it, his foot literally was in my door.
She was of tremendous help. She was frightened.
Frightened about what?
She was frightened she was being followed. She was frightened of intimidation, of pressure, of losing her job, of the wrath of her coworkers.
Carl wanted very much for me to name names, and that terrified me. I just knew I was going to see that in the paper the next morning.
She would not tell us who those people were, but she was the first one to tell us that there was an authority, a higher authority, that dispersed, had the authority to disperse this money. And then we were able to go to Hugh Sloan,
who was the treasurer.
Who was the treasurer of the committee. And who,
re-elect
Mrs.
the president.
Hoback had said to me, look, this guy is an honest man, and he quit because he's an honest man.
Bernstein and Woodward were more persistent than the rest, I guess. That's probably why they got in the front hall where the others didn't. Interesting combination, sort of the good guy, bad guy approach. Their whole approach to me was along the lines that we don't believe you're involved, but in essence, you ought to protect yourself if you can.
Hugh Sloan was somebody who had quit at this time, didn't like what he saw, didn't know what it all meant, but said to us that there was a cash fund of $500,000, maybe $700,000, and he would make disbursements under the authority of certain people. Very key, follow the money, who controls the money. And our stories in the Washington Post before the 72 election focused on this secret fund and who controlled it, and the key people were Haldeman, Stans, and Mitchell.
And how much do you think that publicity attending this case is hurting President Nixon's re-election campaign?
Not in the slightest. I don't believe it'll hurt in the slightest for the very simple reason that neither the president, obviously, or anybody in the White House, or anybody in authority in any of the committees working for the re-election of the president have any responsibility for it.
11:30 at night, 12:30 at night, Carl Bernstein calls the Attorney General of the United States at home and tells him what?
Well, he said that they were running the story that Mitchell controlled that money and said they wanted to check this story with him. Mm-hmm. He said, well, are you going to run this? And if you are, Katie Graham's tit is going to get caught in a ringer. There you are. I said it.
We reflected on the Attorney General's remark about where Mrs. Graham's arrangements were going to get caught, and we thought that they were serious about that. As it turned out, they sure as hell were.
Well, were there actual things undertaken by the White House to get back at you people?
Well, you know that Florida, that the FCC had this rule that all television license has to be renewed every 3 years. In the state of Florida, the Post owned two television stations, neither of which had ever been challenged in the history of television.
Right.
And suddenly there were three or four challenges, including Rebozo, including all the representatives of the Florida Committee to Re-elect.
B.B. Rebozo?
B.B. Rebozo.
Richard Nixon's best friend.
Richard Nixon's best friend.
Who else was on the White House hit list? That story in a moment.
A shell and two starfishes.
It's called Me Day.
My mom says he looks like my daddy's boss.
It's the day when everyone in Mrs. Meyer's first grade brings something from home.
My daddy cut it for me.
And shares it with the rest of the class.
Jack, you want to come on up?
On this Tuesday morning, Jack Moore brought something different.
This is my dad. His name is Jack, like me. Last Saturday, we built a doghouse. Maybe someday I'll get a dog. Every Saturday morning, we let Mom sleep and we go to McDonald's together. That's where we tell each other things we'd never tell anybody else.
At McDonald's, we never planned on being part of Jack Moore's Me Day, but we're glad we were.
This is my dad. He's my best friend.
This Father's Day, Sears has some terrific gift ideas. Like this rugged Craftsman 3/8 inch variable speed drill, only $29.99. Make your dad feel special this Father's Day with Craftsman, only from Sears.
At the first tickly itch of athlete's foot, Detonex. Killing those grungy fungi before they get cracking and burning. Go get that can now, or else don't blame Detonex.
What was the most expensive movie ever made? If you said Terminator 2, you're right. What New England town's the setting for Murder, She Wrote? If you answered Cabot Cove, you're right again. On what two planets does Total Recall take place? If you said Earth and Mars, you really know movies. What was the most watched television program in history? If you said the final episode of MASH, you're ready to play the ultimate movie TV trivia game. So join host Bob Goen for the Hollywood Game, Friday on CBS Primetime.
Has a dead lover returned from the grave?
There is no way Suzanne could have survived that explosion.
Or is she a deadly double?
No!
Dangerous Curves, tonight.
Two National League rivals battle it out when Gwynn and McGriff ignite the Padres against Will Clark and the Giants. Saturday, 2:30 Eastern on CBS.
You remember your high school prom? Some things never change.
Your senior prom should just be the most special night of high school.
Some things will never be the same.
Drugs, alcohol, guns, knives.
Make a date for prom night. It's a night they'll never forget. An all-new 48 hours, 2 weeks from tonight.
All of a sudden, I said to Woodward, this president is going to be impeached. I don't know where that thought came from. I can remember feeling this chill go through me when I said it, because this was in September, early September of 1972. I said, this president is going to be impeached because of this. Even now saying it, I can feel it. It's very strange. And Woodward looked at me and he said, my God, you're right.
The president of the United States.
Just 2 weeks before the election, and though the Watergate burglars had been indicted, the polls show Nixon way ahead. Watergate stories are getting little attention from the press or the public. And then from Woodward and Bernstein, a blockbuster.
You remember the story? Nixon's chief of staff. He had been named, they heard, in front of a grand jury as control of the secret slush fund.
$375,000. I sort of remember that, Mike. Yes, I do.
Yeah.
Now that you bring it up.
And? But tell the story.
Well, the story was that there was a secret slush fund, $375,000 under Haldeman's control in the White House for special tricks and for use as he saw fit. And We checked it, sent it back, checked it again, sent it back. To my satisfaction, it was right. And then in the lowest moment of the whole thing, the following morning, I'll never forget seeing...
After printing it on the front page?
Printing it on the front page, rather big. And there was Dan Shaw shoving a microphone into Sloan's face.
I'd like my attorney to answer the question.
I assume you're referring to the testimony before the grand jury as reported in the Washington Post this morning?
Correct.
Our answer to that is an unequivocal no. We did not. Mr. Sloan did not implicate Mr. Haldeman in that testimony at all.
And my heart sank. It was just, you know, it didn't seem to me how we could hedge a denial. It was just, no, the story was wrong.
All the blood ran out of our system, and we wondered what had happened.
Well, we made a mistake.
What do you mean you made a mistake?
We made an error. We said that Haldeman had been named before the grand jury, presumably by Sloan. I think we said by Sloan. When, in fact, he hadn't been named by Sloan.
I don't respect the type of journalism, the shabby journalism that is being practiced by the Washington Post. And I've stated that view to you. Now, you ask what motivates the Washington Post to do this? They'll have to answer for that.
Well, it was desperate. I mean, it was desperate because it gave the silent colleagues a chance to say, see, the Post is out there all alone. And we're right to leave them all alone in that.
And what happened to rescue from it?
Well, they went back and back and back, and finally they came and said, you know, we were wrong. It wasn't $375,000. It was $700,000. And the mistake which allowed Sloan to deny it was that he didn't tell the grand jury that because he wasn't asked.
We were hurting. We'd written all of these things. Lots of people didn't believe them. We were out on one long limb. And there were lots of saws working on that limb.
And no one is with you. I mean, no one.
In October, there was we had one ally.
Walter Cronkite.
At first, it was called the Watergate Caper. Five men, apparently caught in the act of burglarizing and bugging Democratic headquarters in Washington. But the episode grew steadily more sinister.
It wasn't up until your network gave 15 minutes of airtime to our stories in late October that our reporting got any prominence. Our colleagues in the press ignored us or disbelieved us.
It was a big kiss from Walter. It was
Bill Paley, the CBS equivalent of Catherine Graham, was not particularly happy about it.
Yeah. All good work is done in defiance of management.
Bill Paley, the man at the top of CBS, said, what in the world are you people doing?
True. He said that to Dick Salant again, not to me personally or anybody involved in the program.
The president of CBS News.
He said, I thought we overdid it last night. I thought we used too much time. I think it's unbalancing the program, appears to be some kind of a crusade or something of the sort. It would be better if it were shorter. And let's shorten it down to tonight. Don't take the same amount of time you took last night.
This is Dick Salant to you.
Salant to our production team. I didn't know till weeks later, maybe months later, I think months later, did I know that this was a direct Colson to Paley, Paley to Salant complaint.
Oh, yeah. Bill Paley called me many times. I remember one Saturday morning in the fall of 72 and apologized for a 13-minute news segment on Watergate, which he said was in the middle of a political campaign, was violating the Fairness Doctrine. He said, I've been talking to the news department, trying to change them, and he said, I'm having difficulty, but trust me, I'll keep working on it.
I had what at that time was a fairly high-ranking person at CBS News tell somebody, as a call rather than tell him to get his ass off this story, because he's going to wreck the newscast, he's going to wreck the network. I mean, he's out there too far.
Really?
And at this point, what we were doing and all we were doing was the best of the Washington Post stories.
I went through life saying this is the purest form of journalism in which I've ever worked, including magazines and newspapers. I had to back off of that when I learned the truth about the Watergate episode, since clearly top management had interfered with the broadcast.
It is only since internal White House memoranda have been released that the ferocity of Nixon's attempts to muzzle the press has become clear. Item, from Haldeman's notes, hit rather about his attitude. You owe the president an apology.
Why did they hate you so? They hated you.
Well, it's now clear that's true. I think, one, because I insisted on at least trying to be independent. Two, because I work for CBS News. I think there was a sense, exaggerated, but a sense that they had ways of influencing a lot of people on the beat, either through their editors or publishers or through granting of favors, all the ways that guys, politicians from county courthouses and city halls and state legislatures do it, but in very sophisticated ways. They had a sense with me, Mike, and look, I made my mistakes, but one mistake I didn't make was trying to please them.
The Nixon landslide that was predicted seems to be turning into a reality.
Richard Nixon is reelected. Landslide.
Yep.
Despite the Washington Post, despite Walter Cronkite's
right
stories.
Well, he got reelected, and that's the American way. No one had, it didn't change our conviction that something was rotten, but it slowed down our ability to do anything about it. We couldn't get it.
We'll be back in a moment.
Flakes? What can I say? I mean, they look kind of stupid just sitting there. Lights out, nobody's home. I mean, look, there's no fruit, there's no raisins, there's nothing in here. There's something about this. It's kind of simple. It's really crunchy. You know, I like them.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes? Cool.
Taste them again for the first time.
Personnel, please.
Seventh floor.
Now, when life turns up the heat, there's Degree antiperspirant. Because it's body heat activated, Degree turns on extra protection when you really need it. Degree, your body heat turns it on.
Father's Day. Dads want Dockers, Levi's Dockers, and they're all on sale at Sears. These Docker Twills are just $23.99. Shorts just $19.99. Dads want Dockers, and they're all on sale at Sears.
At Acura, we believe that a luxury sedan should appeal to a driver's appreciation of soft leather, fine wood, and beautiful stretches of asphalt. The Acura Legend Sedan.
There's a new winner in mustard. In a nationwide taste test, new Hellmann's Dijonnais Creamy Mustard Blend beat the leading mustard by 2-1.
You know, when I opened up that lunchbox and I saw that my sweetheart had made that ham sandwich with delicious new Hellmann's Dijonnais, well, I knew I was in love.
Oh, nothing beats new Hellmann's Dijonnais.
We're all sitting in Senator Irvin's office, and he turned to us and he said, "You know what the president was yelling on the phone to me? You have to get me! You have to get me! You have to get me!"
Watergate, the secret story, continues in just a moment. Patients love it. Surgeons swear by this new technique, and its popularity is soaring. So what's the problem?
It is extremely hard until you know how to do it.
What questions can you ask your doctor to avoid becoming a surgical guinea pig? Find out on Eye on America on the CBS Evening News with Dan Rather tomorrow.
Something new is coming to CBS, filled with intrigue, suspense, and danger.
Cannot use the women of this city as bait.
Lee Horsley heads a team of investigators.
M.O. Raped and strangled.
For them, crime is a work of passion.
The more intense the case, the more intense the sex.
Bodies of Evidence premieres Thursday.
This is CBS.
With a Chase Manhattan credit card, you can skip a payment on whatever month of the year you choose. We're flexible.
Do you remember that story about the three bears?
This was too big.
That was too small. And finally, something fit just right. Like the new J30 from Infiniti. Now that's my definition of luxury. It's a car you just slip right into and live happily ever after. Infiniti. Makes you want to take up driving again, doesn't it?
Some people just know how to fly.
Flying?
Flying.
I'll show you how to fly.
They set a goal and they aim it high.
Excuse me?
This is flying.
You guys call that flying?
Maybe. They call that flying. Wrong. Northwest is flying.
Fly Northwest. 47,000 people bringing you the best on-time performance in the country.
So with this flavorizer system,
right,
you can just put the food in and walk away?
Hey, that's the beauty of cruise control.
Genesis, the Weber of gas grills.
Get on board with Channel 7, the only Boston television station that's an official sponsor of Sail Boston. WHDH-TV, the one to watch.
I went up to see him, related what I had found out, and I said, Mr. President, this is my advice to you. Get on the television and tell the American people just what the hell happened. And he said, that's a good idea, and I'm going to do it. Well, he never did it. And that's what started my whole interest in the thing. Because I don't like people to tell me a lie.
Let us go forward from here, confident in hope, strong in our faith in one another, sustained by our faith in God who created us, and striving always to serve his purpose.
January 20th, 1973. There was no mention of Watergate on the steps of the Capitol that inauguration day, though Howard Hunt and four of the burglars had already pled guilty to conspiracy, burglary, and illegal wiretapping. 10 days later, it would take a jury only 90 minutes to find Gordon Liddy and James McCord guilty as well. In early February, the Senate voted for hearings to look into the Watergate affair. Chief counsel to the committee, Sam Dash.
Whenever you are investigating a major cover-up and a major crime of this kind, which involves very powerful people and conspirators, this could be organized crime, white-collar crime, or the crime in the Oval Office, it's very difficult to get people who were involved in the conspiracy to talk to you. I mean, either they're afraid or either they got reasons not to talk, which could be power and could be money. And therefore, you need a crack. You really have to crack that wall of silence.
The first crack in the wall came the day that sentences were to be handed down to the Watergate Seven, when James McCord, one of the seven, handed Judge John Sirica a letter. In it, McCord said that political pressure had been applied to the defendants to plead guilty and to remain silent, that there had been perjured testimony at the trial, and that the CIA had been unfairly dragged into the entire affair.
I'm absolutely certain I did exactly the right thing. The timing was right. And it's very essential that all the facts that have come to light, come to light.
McCord was a burglar. He didn't sit in on White House meetings. He didn't know about Mitchell. He didn't know about lots of people. But it was a start of somebody saying, look, we were paid, we were intimidated, we were given promises, and the basis of the trial was perjury.
It must have sent a message through all of Washington that this is going someplace now.
There was a sense of government's foundation is now shaking.
Then the foundation began to crumble. Jeb Magruder, who would run Nixon's re-election committee, began talking to the prosecutor.
Mr. Magruder, were you involved in anything?
He implicated John Mitchell and White House counsel John Dean in the break-in.
I'm sorry, I have no comment.
In quick order, John Dean was trying to cut a deal with the prosecutors and the Senate committee.
Today, in one of the most difficult decisions of my presidency, I accepted the resignations of two of my closest associates in the White House, Bob Haldeman, John Ehrlichman.
That same day, the president would accept the resignations of John Dean and Attorney General Richard Kleindienst, who had replaced John Mitchell 11 months earlier. He was now being replaced by Elliot Richardson, and Richardson promptly named a special prosecutor in the Watergate case, Archibald Cox.
We were determined that the law would prevail. And that's an awesome task when you have the entire White House apparatus determined otherwise.
Committee will come to order.
This is how America finally learned about Watergate and what a spectacle it was. The nation was transfixed as witness after witness was brought in front of the Watergate committee to tell their part of the Watergate story. None more fascinating than White House counsel John Dean.
Dean perhaps held the key to the Watergate scandal and perhaps the key to the involvement of the president, if there was any involvement. And therefore, he was somebody who played such an important role as a broker and a mediator and a pusher that he was an essential witness.
I told him
that all I've been able to do was to contain the case and assist in keeping it out of the White House.
For 5 days, in a deliberate and steady monotone, John Dean laid out the entire affair from break-in to cover-up, implicating all the president's men, implicating the president. He freely admitted that as the president's lawyer, all things related to the Watergate scandal went through him at one time or another. He controlled the cover-up.
The president told me I'd done a good job, and he appreciated how difficult a task it had been, and the president was pleased that the case had stopped with Liddy.
Dean told the committee of a conversation it had with the president earlier that year, on March 21st, when he realized he could no longer keep things under control.
I began by telling the president that there was a cancer growing on the presidency, and if the cancer was not removed, the president himself would be killed by it.
The investigation was getting closer and closer to the White House. Obviously, President Nixon was feeling the heat, although he was trying to convince the people he was on top of government, and he was paying very little attention to Watergate. The fact is, he was consumed by the Watergate issue.
Let me remind you that the finest steel has to go through the hottest fire. And I can assure you, my friends, this room is full of fine steel tonight. Thank you.
More testimony damaging to the president. L. Patrick Gray, no longer FBI director, told the senators about a conversation he had with Richard Nixon in which he warned the president of a conspiracy by his closest advisors to obstruct justice.
Mr. President, there is something I want to speak to you about. Dick Walters and I feel that people on your staff are trying to mortally wound you by using the CIA and FBI.
The committee continued to zero in on the president. For weeks, they had been demanding that Mr. Nixon send over presidential documents relevant to the Watergate inquiry, and he was balking. So the committee chairman, Sam Ervin, decided to try the personal touch and telephoned him.
We're all sitting in Senator Ervin's office, and we could only hear one side of the conversation. And then suddenly, Ervin's face got flushed. Well, no, Mr. President. No, we're not out to get you, Mr. President. No, Mr. President, we just want to get at the facts. No, Mr. President, we're not out to get you, Mr. President. No, and his face was getting flusher and flusher, and he finally hung up. And he turned to us and he said, you know what the president was yelling on the phone to me? You have to get me! You have to get me! You have to get me!
The president and Bob Haldeman on a tape you've never heard before. Stay tuned.
What's been the highlight of your late getting a stop, Matt?
I'd say this new honey barbecue chicken, Russ.
Get two pieces with baked beans, coleslaw, and a biscuit in a Roundup meal for just $2.99. Or the eight-piece meal, just $9.99.
Oh, what?
Now get to KFC as quick as you can. Honey barbecue wings are back, glazed in a special sauce with a touch of honey. People are rushing to try them. KFC honey barbecue wings in Lake Edna or your neck of the woods.
Now's the best time to protect your home with Sears Weather Beater. Because right now, Weather Beater Satin Finish exterior paint is on sale, just $15.99 a gallon. Sale ends Saturday, so hurry to the paint store you can count on. Sears.
On June 22nd, you'll meet a sedan that's not like everybody else's. Until then, you just have to wait, like everybody else. The all-new Mazda 626.
Now, we hardly even advertise this, and it's practically flying off the shelves. So what attracted you to it?
The name of the dressing attracted my attention. Healthy Sensation is perfect. It is sensational.
And this one just jumped off the shelf at you?
Yeah, well...
Did it hit you in the head?
No, it missed.
What do you think is in there that makes it a sensation?
Carrots and peppers. My husband liked it. He was the tough one.
You wouldn't change the name to... Wow, is that a wonderful thing or what?
Well, that's a long title to put on a salad dressing bottle.
Healthy Sensation Salad Dressing. The name says it all.
Friday, two gentlemen in their 70s are out to prove that life is worth living at any age.
He's in the pond.
With all the ups.
How high up do those stockings go?
I'm wearing pantyhose.
What a shame.
All the downs.
You mean he's gone off his rocker, don't you? Damn you, look at me.
And with all the love. Emmy Award winners Hume Cronin and Vincent Gardenia are age-old friends Friday.
I mean, my God, once the hearing started, I could walk from my office to the Capitol and never miss a beat in the television hearings. I could hear it. I could hear radio in the cabs. I could see it in offices. It overwhelmed the city.
Mr. Butterfield, are you aware of the installation of any listening devices in the Oval Office of the President?
I was aware of listening devices.
July 16th, Alexander Butterfield, who was a deputy assistant to the president, shocked the nation. A taping system had been installed in the White House years earlier and was known to just a few Nixon aides.
He didn't want to commit perjury, and so he was squeezed. And when asked a question, actually by a minority counsel, when asked a question relating to tapes, he said, well, I assume you know about it, but you're asking me about one tape. It wasn't one tape. It was a taping system that recorded 24 hours a day all the conversations in the Oval Office for the past 2 years. And boom, you know, what an explosion.
What you're about to hear is the actual tape of a conversation between Richard Nixon and his chief of staff, Bob Haldeman. The Nixon tapes to this day are not available for broadcast, but we have managed to obtain one. And on it, in the irony of ironies, Richard Nixon wonders if John Dean had secretly taped the meeting in which Dean warned him of a cancer growing on the presidency.
But the point is, that's a real bomb, isn't it?
Yeah.
Sure is. That's what may be his bomb. In other words, you kind of put that on the desk, says, I got a recording of the President of the United States, and here's what he said.
Well, that would be very hard.
If he did it, we'd say yes.
Impossible.
Well, not virtually impossible. If he did it, we'd say, yes, sir, that was a recording, and I was investigating.
That's right.
But on the other hand, it'd be goddamn hard. I mean, you run that in the press, that'd be pretty... But, well, no way to find out, is there?
No. I really don't think it's so remote as to be almost beyond the realm of possibility.
It doesn't matter nothing as we're beyond the realm of possibility.
No, that's true. But, And
but, of course, he draws a sword on that.
I think if that's the subject he has in mind, that he's just going to do it on the basis of his own, you know, his own record afterwards or something.
That's right. Oh, well, on that, we'll destroy him.
And
he's his word against,
you know, from the basis
his word against,
or something like that.
His word against the president's.
The tapes would be irrefutable evidence of guilt or innocence. And Special Prosecutor Archibald Cox immediately subpoenaed 8 of them. The battle was joined.
If I were to make public these tapes, containing as they do blunt and candid remarks on many different subjects, the confidentiality of the office of the president would always be suspect from now on.
While the fight over the tapes escalated over the next 3 months, even more staggering events were unfolding. On October 6th, war broke out in the Middle East, causing a confrontation between the United States and the Soviet Union.
Flatly deny the assertions.
In the same week, Vice President Spiro Agnew was forced to resign in yet another scandal involving charges of income tax evasion.
Well, I had the feeling the country was collapsing because, you see, the President of the United States, wounded, flailing around trying to defend himself before Archibald Cox, and I'm engineering the resignation and keeping out of jail the Vice President of the United States. A terrible moment.
Nixon was surrounded by lawyers on every side. Then the tapes decision came down from the Court of Appeals. Deliver the tapes. More lawyers. More meetings about what could be done, what couldn't be done.
Still, Nixon refused to give up the tapes, and Archibald Cox was about to have him held in contempt.
This was, I think, the most profound moment of Watergate, because no one wants to have a president of the United States held in criminal contempt. So Mr. Cox was explaining why he felt he had to take this awful step of proceeding forward despite the president's apparent orders as chief law enforcement officer under the Constitution of the United States.
While it was not clear who was constitutionally on the side of right, it was abundantly clear who had the power. And the result was what came to be known as the Saturday Night Massacre.
This is a special report. Here is CBS White House correspondent Dan Rather. Good evening. In breathtaking succession tonight, the following historic events occurred.
The President of the United States demanded that the Attorney General fire Special Prosecutor Archibald Cox. The Attorney General, Elliot Richardson, refused and resigned. The President then ordered the Assistant Attorney General, William Ruckelshaus, to fire the Special Prosecutor. Ruckelshaus refused. The President immediately fired Ruckelshaus. Solicitor General Robert Bork was ordered to fire Special Prosecutor Cox. He did. The FBI, acting upon orders from the President, sealed off the Special Prosecutor's office.
I must say, I suppose that human emotions take over in this kind of occasion, because one thinks that in a democracy maybe this would not happen.
It was an instantaneous reaction, and a lot of it was from Republicans who were disgusted that their man, Richard Nixon, had said, I am above the law, and I'm going to fire the guy who's trying to uphold the law. And it was pretty clear to us that this act of trying to abolish our office, firing Mr. Cox, to me, it was just a straight obstruction of justice.
I think that the impeachment process was tremendously accelerated by the firing of Cox, by the reaction to the resignation of Richardson and Ruckelshaus, by the huge media din that took place at that point, that treated this thing as if it were World War III breaking out. I mean, everything else was drowned out. You didn't even know that there was a crisis in the Middle East at that point. And I think that really was the second stage rocket that put the impeachment process into orbit, from which it never descended until the resignation.
All those in favor of
3 days after the Saturday Night Massacre, 22 bills of impeachment were introduced in Congress, and the President released the subpoenaed tapes.
There would have been those who would have said that the President is defying the law. This President does not defy the law.
The first day in November, Leon Jaworski was sworn in as the new special prosecutor, and his first confrontation with the President was a stunner. A critical tape recorded 2 days after the break-in between Nixon and his chief of staff, H.R. Haldeman, had an 18-and-a-half-minute erasure.
President Nixon today has agreed to permit court-appointed electronic experts examine the tapes to determine once and for all the absence of any alteration to the tapes.
Those experts found the 18-and-a-half-minute erasure was deliberate, not accidental.
There's so many tapes, there were so many meetings. It really is an incredible amount of evidence. And they would have had to have something like the 18,500-minute gap to get it all erased.
Here is another tape, also a conversation between the President and Bob Haldeman. On it, they discuss the charges that hush money was paid to the Watergate burglars.
I just don't know how it's going to come out, though. That's the whole point. And I just don't know. Is that when I was serious when I said to John at the end there, I says, God damn it, all these guys that participated in raising the money and so forth have got to stick to the line that they did not raise this money to obstruct justice.
Well, I sure didn't think they were. I didn't think they were, and I don't think they did.
Well, with
maybe some exceptions.
Right. I think now... We pretty much know what the worst is. I don't know what the hell else they could have that's any worse. You know what I mean? Unless, you know,
that's right.
Unless there's, you know, I mean, I don't know that unless somebody's got some piece of paper that somebody signed or some goddamn thing, but that I doubt.
It doesn't appear that there is such a thing.
On March 1st, the Watergate grand jury indicted seven people, including Haldeman, Ehrlichman, and Mitchell, and named the President, Richard Nixon, as an unindicted co-conspirator.
The committee will be in order.
The House Judiciary Committee had been gathering evidence since January on articles of impeachment, the impeachment of Richard Nixon. And for them, the best evidence to make their judgment was the tapes. Everyone wanted them. This committee, the special prosecutors, everyone.
On April 11th, the Judiciary Committee issued a subpoena for 42 additional tapes.
As a compromise, the President offered edited transcripts.
They include all the relevant portions of all of the subpoenaed conversations that were recorded.
No one was buying. The matter would have to be decided by the Supreme Court. Think of this. The United States of America versus Richard Nixon. The stakes were never higher. The court decided 8-0, that the president must turn over the tapes to the special prosecutor. It was a monumental decision.
For the first time, you really had a ruling that a president of the United States is not above the law, that the law will prevail over a president's desire to keep something secret, even though that something is quite relevant to proving a crime.
Mr. Rangel.
Aye.
Ms. Jordan.
Aye.
Over the next week, the House Judiciary Committee voted on 3 articles of impeachment.
No.
They all passed.
Mr. Rodino.
Aye.
Before the full House had a chance to vote on whether or not to put the president on trial, the White House released one more tape, the meeting between Haldeman and the president 6 days after the break-in. And there was the smoking gun. Nixon clearly telling Haldeman to obstruct justice by getting the CIA to block the FBI investigation of Watergate. No one could defend that.
And I just blew my stack. I said, to my colleagues, this is all I'm going to take. I'm going up and talk to the president. I didn't know what the hell I'd talk about, but I was going to go up and talk to him. Mm-hmm. The president was on a needle, and we had to be very careful, because he'd fall one way or the other off that needle, and if he fell in favor of the Congress trying him, we could be in a bad fix in this country for government for maybe 6, 7, or 8 months.
While the impeachment proceedings went on.
That's right. So we sat there in the Oval Room, and the president acted like he just played golf and just had a hole in one. You'd never think this guy's tail was in a crack. So finally he said to me, Barry, what do you think my chances are in the Senate? Well, I said, you might get 10 votes. He said, let me think about it. So we left, and the press was outside, and we went out and talked to them and said what we thought we could say, which wasn't too much.
There's been no decision made. We made no suggestions. We were merely there to offer what we see as a condition on both floors.
I called Ben Bradley, and I called his boss.
Kay Graham?
Yeah. I said, now, I know there's a hell of a story cooking up here, but you do the country a big favor if you don't print it.
I guess Goldwater thought that if we hammered him too hard, he'd say, to hell with it, I'm going to stay here. Let him, I'll bring down the country with me.
Hold it. Barry Goldwater comes out of that house across the street, calls his old pal Ben Bradley and says, Ben, he's going to resign, but don't print this, because if you print it, he won't resign.
From my point of view, he was saying, I think he is going to go, and I think he's going to go if you guys don't hammer him apart in the next 24 hours.
And you wanted to see him go, therefore you decided to hold your fire.
I decided that I would listen to my friend, and whose wisdom in these matters exceeded mine.
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow. Vice President Ford will be sworn in as president at that hour in this office.
Richard Nixon telephoned you after his speech of resignation. What did he tell you?
He called to tell me he was sorry. And he said, I know I let you down. He said, he speculated, what do you think's gonna happen with me? I said, well, I don't know. I just can't imagine that they will proceed further. I think that it would be too hurtful, too wounding. And he said, well, it's not the worst thing in the world. He said, some of the best writing has taken place in jail. Referred to Gandhi, I remember that specifically. And then he said, give my best to your wife and to the kids and take good care of yourself.
Who do you think Deep Throat is? We'll tell you who we think he is when we return.
Morning! What's for breakfast in modern times?
Oh, just cereal.
Back in my century, we enjoyed grains kept whole for a more natural, hearty taste.
New Great Grains.
You bet it's great. Toasted wheat, oats, and barley. Kept whole. Full of flavor.
Great. Dates, raisins, even pecans. This really is delicious.
Now I'm hungry. Got another bowl?
What was great back then is great grains now. A great new cereal from Post.
Looks great. But come on, I mean, you know, you could have gotten yourself another BMW or a Lexus.
I suppose. But why? This had everything I wanted. Power, great handling, ABS.
Yeah, but
airbag, leather, everything. I couldn't see spending $10,000-$20,000 more for what?
Who makes it?
Pontiac. It's the new Bonneville.
Nice. It's a very sophisticated system. You're probably better off taking it to the GM dealership.
We haven't got that kind of equipment here. Best bet's the dealership.
Pretty tricky stuff. Out of our league.
Sorry. Try the dealership.
The dealership?
The GM dealership.
For a few short weeks at Red Lobster, we're putting together lobster, crab, and shrimp. Don't miss our best combinations ever. For just a limited time, lobster, crab, and shrimp. Tonight at Red Lobster.
Hi, this is Phil Rizzuto for The Money Store. For our 25th anniversary, The Money Store is offering a special loan program, the 25-year fixed-rate second mortgage. This second mortgage payment plan is the lowest we've ever offered in our 25-year history. With today's low rates, now is a great time to lock in your loan payments and still get a tax deduction on the interest. So, for our lowest payment plan ever, call 1-800-LOAN-YES. That's The Money Store at 1-800-LOAN-YES.
One individual.
One individual.
Still alive.
Still alive.
Who just doesn't want to come forward.
That's correct.
And history does not need him to come forward.
Well, I wish he would come forward. I wanted him to come forward when we wrote All the President's Men.
Well, I know, but 20 years later, why doesn't he?
He's got very good reasons.
Who do you think Deep Throat is? We'll tell you who we think he is when we return.
Two National League rivals battle it out when Gwynn and McGriff ignite the Padres against Will Clark and the Giants. Saturday, 2:30 Eastern on CBS.
There's a mystery writer named Fletcher whose friends often leave on a stretcher. She'll snoop and she'll quote, "It's murder she wrote. She's clever, so you'll want to catch her." Then, she witnessed her husband attack his mistress.
Killed her.
Now only a stranger with a secret can save her. Robert Urich, Marky Post, Stranger at My Door, Sunday.
This is CBS.
Never seen nothing like it. I mean, Rusty Slade was an ornery sort. Always ate his old bran flakes just for fiber. But one morning, I gave him Kellogg's new complete bran flakes. Weren't the same. More than fiber, they had whole grain wheat. Flakes were new too, crispy, crunchy. Why, that Kellogg's Complete Bran Flakes even had a better nutty taste. It was all so good, made Rusty smile. Almost. New Kellogg's Complete Bran Flakes. Fiber and then some.
Watch News 7 tonight at 11, and here's what you'll see.
Boris Yeltsin salutes President Bush during dinner at the Russian embassy, but he's still troubled by the possibility that questions about American POWs could delay U.S. aid. In Holliston, a family tragedy, Kenneth Seguin, charged with killing his wife, faces new charges of killing his two young children. Join us for those stories and more tonight on News 7 at 11.
Here are tonight's winning Megabucks numbers drawn earlier this evening.
Egoist, a fragrance out of the ordinary for a man out of the ordinary. Egoist, from Chanel. At Filene's.
Stop whatever you're doing and hurry to your New England Ford dealers. Because the company who brought you 5 of the 10 best-selling vehicles in America now present vacation values on Ford's vacation vehicles. Now, during our leadership celebration, lease the new 93 Escort wagon for just $199 a month for 24 months. We also have special lease plans on Aerostar, the hot-selling Ford Explorer, and the Taurus wagon, America's favorite station wagon with available dual airbags and anti-lock brakes. Vacation values. More reasons why Ford makes it smart to lease now.
Watergate Revisited. Get the inside story on Entertainment Tonight.
I don't believe that Deep Throat was
an FBI official or an FBI agent.
Like, it had to be one on the inside of the White House and one on the outside in CREP. Because nobody could have had that comprehensive information, no one man.
I think it's a fictional compilation that was created. I think it's a number of sources.
Might have been Al Haig. I find that really hard to believe that it would have been Al Haig. But I am not. Trust me, I'm not.
I mean, everybody has his price. If there were a deep throat, we would have long ago seen him.
You won't get it out of me. Not the best day you ever had.
And so we are left with everybody's favorite final question. Who was Deep Throat? Well, tonight, Woodward, Bernstein, and Bradley have stated unequivocally that Deep Throat is not a composite character, that he is real, he is a man who is alive and still wants his identity protected. What Woodward and Bernstein have written about Deep Throat, they say, is absolutely true, including the dates on which Bob Woodward supposedly met in Washington with Deep Throat. Those dates effectively eliminate three men whose names have often been mentioned.
Alexander Haig, Deputy National Security Advisor and subsequently White House Chief of Staff, Henry Kissinger, National Security Advisor and Secretary of State, and Mel Laird, Secretary of Defense and later Counselor to the President. All were out of the country on at least one occasion when Woodward and Deep Throat got together. It is not inconceivable, but hard to imagine that some relatively unknown figure in the executive branch could have known all that Deep Throat knew. The FBI has long been a focus of attention because much of Deep Throat's most detailed information involves that agency and its leadership. Mark Felt, the deputy director of the FBI, who Richard Nixon once said was Deep Throat, claims he only met with Woodward once during Watergate and told us, in fact, that he refused to cooperate with Woodward whenever Woodward called him. Woodward incidentally describes Deep Throat as a heavy smoker, and Mark Felt says he gave up smoking in 1943. Who then was Deep Throat? It has long been a guessing game with Watergate buffs. This was the Hollywood version in the film All the President's Men. And Bob Woodward has led us to believe that, in fact, the garage in this movie looks very much like the one where he used to meet with his famous friend. And the director of the film told us that Woodward indicated to him that the actor playing Deep Throat was not miscast. Does the real Deep Throat look like this man? Or has Bob Woodward cleverly disguised his identity in order to protect his source?
Can you tell me what you know?
You tell me what you know.
The story is dry. All we've got are more pieces. We can't seem to figure out what the puzzle is supposed to look like.
You tell me what you know, and I'll confirm. I'll keep you in the right direction if I can, but that's all. Just follow the money.
Was there, in fact, a real Deep Throat? If you take Woodward, Bernstein, and Bradley's word for it, and it's important to point out that many do not, but if you do, there is one person we have come to believe who best fits the given description of Deep Throat. And that is L. Patrick Gray, 76 years old now, former Assistant Attorney General, who was appointed acting director of the FBI 6 weeks before the break-in at the Watergate.
I thank the president.
He started out as a Nixon loyalist, but according to our sources, as Gray was dragged into the Watergate scandal, he became increasingly disgusted with the whole business. He came to loathe dealing with all the president's men. Still, he continued to have unique access to precious information about Watergate through his position at the FBI. In fact, he said he told the president just 3 weeks after the break-in, people on your staff are trying to mortally wound you.
However, what's most baffling to those who have tried to figure out Deep Throat's identity is how such a high-level government official could arrange so many clandestine meetings for hours on end in the middle of the night in an underground parking garage. Who could possibly have done that? L. Patrick Gray lived in a bachelor apartment in this building that has an underground garage to which he could have descended unseen to meet Bob Woodward, who lived only 4 blocks away during much of the Watergate crisis.
Woodward and Deep Throat had worked out a set of bizarre signals to arrange their meetings, that required Deep Throat to check the balcony of Bob Woodward's apartment every morning. L. Patrick Gray could easily have done that on his way to work, or when he used to jog sometimes in the empty streets of Washington before dawn. But was he the kind of man who would have befriended a young reporter? Gray liked the role of mentor. He and Woodward had similar backgrounds in the Navy, and both have a well-known fascination with government. In Gray's language and personal style, he fits Woodward's description of Deep Throat in detail after detail.
Mr. Gray wouldn't talk to us, and he hasn't spoken publicly about Watergate in 20 years. Our sources say that he is still embittered by the experience, and he wouldn't even take a call from Richard Nixon. His lawyer, however, says privately that Mr. Gray categorically denies being Deep Throat and scoffs at such speculation.
Though it's been 20 years since the Watergate break-in, the Stonewall continues. There are others who would not speak with us.
I felt very loyal to the president and very loyal to the other people at the White House.
John Dean served 4 months in prison for his role in the Watergate cover-up. He is now involved in a multi-million-dollar lawsuit over a book about Watergate. Among those he is suing, G. Gordon Liddy.
I think John Dean should have remained loyal to his president.
G. Gordon Liddy served over 4 years in prison for his role in the Watergate break-in, the Ellsberg burglary, and contempt of court. Liddy is now a radio talk show host in our nation's capital.
If I had to do it all over again, I would have fired Gordon Liddy when I had the chance.
Jeb Stuart Magruder served 7 months for the Watergate cover-up. He is now a Presbyterian minister in Kentucky.
I know that legally and morally, I am totally innocent.
H.R. Haldeman served 18 months for the Watergate cover-up. He now manages a number of successful investments in California and Florida.
I don't feel guilty. I know I'm not guilty of the charges.
John Ehrlichman served 8 months in prison for his role in the Watergate cover-up and the Ellsberg break-in. He is now an environmental consultant in Georgia.
You're prettier than ever.
Thank you. Can you characterize your testimony in there?
Yes, it was long.
John Mitchell served 19 months for his role in the Watergate cover-up. He died in November of 1988.
But I'm certainly relieved that this is all over with now, and I can start getting my life back together again.
Donald Segretti served 4.5 months in prison for distribution of illegal campaign literature. He practices law in California.
The sentence imposed by Judge Gazelle was a just one.
Eagle Krogh served 4.5 months for his role in the Ellsberg break-in. After several attempts, Krogh was reinstated to the bar and practices law in Washington State. Hugh Sloan left Washington during the Watergate crisis. He now runs an auto parts company in Michigan. Judy Hoback is still keeping books, now in Florida. Henry Ruth is a defense lawyer for white-collar criminals in a national law firm. Sam Dash is a law professor in Washington, D.C. Howard Hunt served 33 months for the Watergate burglary. Hunt has been author of over 70 spy novels. Charles Colson served almost 7 months for obstruction of justice in the Ellsberg case. He now runs the Prison Fellowship Ministry in Virginia. Some unforgettable moments from the time of Watergate coming next.
To order a video cassette collector's edition of Watergate, The Secret Story, call 1-800-453-7200. Watergate, The Secret Story, continues in just a moment.
During the Father's Day sale at JCPenney, you'll find all kinds of shirts for all kinds of dads. Shirts for buttoned-up dads at $18, and buttoned-down dads at 2 for 28. Shirts for solid dads at $19.99, and colorful dads at $15.99. You'll save on every shirt in stock during the JCPenney Father's Day sale, which is perfect for dads who wear their hearts on their sleeves.
JCPenney! Your routine, rugged, grueling, day after day. It's even harder when athlete's foot routinely comes back. But today, there's prescription-strength Lotrimin AF. Many types of fungus can cause athlete's foot. But Lotrimin AF is a broad-spectrum medicine, so it kills them all. No wonder it's the brand most recommended by doctors. So while there's no finish line for you, there is for your athlete's foot. Lotrimin AF.
Every business morning, while the rest of the world is getting up, UPS is guaranteeing overnight delivery before 10:30 for far less than other companies charge. And every business morning, more people are waking up to that fact.
Good morning.
Morning.
She witnessed her husband attack his mistress.
He killed her.
But the police aren't looking for him.
He owns the whole damn county, Mrs. Dancy.
They're looking for her.
I want every cruiser we got out here blocking the roads in the county.
She's a woman with nowhere to run.
Finds me, they'll kill me too.
And her only way out is a stranger with everything to hide.
You got me involved the second you step foot on this farm.
An intense psychological thriller. Robert Urich, Marky Post, Stranger at My Door, Sunday.
Has a dead lover returned from the grave?
There is no way Suzanne could have survived that explosion.
Or is she a deadly double?
No!
Dangerous Curves, tonight.
This is Nick. This is the woman he's going to marry. And this is Trouble. If you want to see where trouble leads, quick, turn on the light. Guiding Light, weekdays on CBS.
What was the most expensive film ever made? If you said Terminator 2, you're ready to play the Hollywood game. Premieres Friday at 8, 7 Central on CBS.
Do I understand that you are testifying that the committee to re-elect the president and those associated with them constitute an eleemosynary institution that gave $450,000 to some burglars and their lawyers merely because they felt sorry for them?
Few Americans outside his native North Carolina knew much of Senator Sam Ervin before we found ourselves transfixed in front of our television sets watching the Watergate hearings that he chaired. He liked to call himself a country lawyer, and we learned how he felt about the law from his firm, earthy, wise handling of those proceedings.
The foreign intelligence activities had nothing to do with the opinion of Ellsberg's psychiatrist about his intellectual or emotional or psychological state.
How do you know that, Mr. Chairman?
Because I can understand the English language. It's my mother tongue.
As we said earlier, many of the individuals who were at the center of the inferno that was Watergate had no desire whatever to talk to us. No desire to relive the shame and the dismay that engulfed them 20 years ago. But there are some unforgettable images from that time that will recall for those of you who watched the drama play out what a shocking, what an ugly, and eventually, because the system worked, what a reassuring episode it was in the story of America's 20th century.
I noticed the New York Times story this morning, and it's about the same as every other one I see in the New York Times. I don't believe any of them.
Do you think my husband's that stupid? And whom do you think he's been protecting? Whom?
I have no idea who.
Mr. President, he has been protecting.
Let others wallow in Watergate. We're going to do our job.
Breaking and entering. Wiretapping. Conspiracy to foster prostitution. Conspiracy to commit kidnapping, destruction of government documents, forgery of State Department documents and campaign letters, secret slush funds, laundering money in Mexico, payoffs to silence witnesses, perjury, plans to audit tax returns for political retaliation, theft of psychiatric records, spying by undercover agents, bogus opinion polls, plans to firebomb a building, conspiracy to obstruct justice. All of this by the Law and Order Administration of Richard Nixon.
Is there a question in there somewhere?
I have never heard or seen such outrageous, vicious, distorted reporting in 27 years of public life.
The abuse of power is a wonderful story. It's a wonderful story. It goes to the very heart of democracy. Power corrupts,
What do you think of Richard Nixon today?
I think he's an enigma. I think he's the most interesting political figure, certainly that I know, because of his unknown quantities to me. If I could have my wish of who I would like to talk to for 10 days, each of us full of truth serum, I would pick Richard Nixon.
Everyone listens to Nixon. He's the most fascinating political figure of this century, even now. No question about it. He has no political power, and his effort to portray himself as kind of an American version of the retired Winston Churchill, writing books and dispensing wisdom, will get thrown right back on its ass when the historians dig into the Watergate record, which there's nothing like it. And there's going to be more of it, and people are going to realize and connect the dots and say, my God, we had a criminal president.
I don't think there's any question but that Richard Nixon was paranoid about enemies. He saw them everywhere. He lived in a kind of an atmosphere of me versus them. You could see it in his eyes. His eyes were kind of shifting as if they're there. They're somewhere in the walls or somewhere in the room. I actually saw him one night at a White House state dinner with his eyes, strangely enough, going around the molding of the room like this. People were all looking up to see. I was looking up. I thought he was seeing a mouse or something up there, you know.
May 19th, 1974, the NAB convention down in Houston. You get up to ask a Watergate question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Dan Rather with CBS News.
You identify yourself and the audience applauds. The president asks,
are you running for something? No, sir, Mr. President, are you? Mr. President.
He knew better than anybody what there was about to be exposed. But he was using all of his experience to try to throw the questioner off balance and also to make you think twice. It was his way of saying, okay, give me your best shot, but recognize who you're talking to here and know you may have to pay a price. This is the interplay.
You suffered as a result of that, though. You became a kind of victim of Watergate yourself, no?
Well, I never saw myself as a victim. But I did realize this, Mike, and I talked about it with my wife, Jean, a number of times. I may not be the smartest guy on the run. I certainly wasn't at the White House, but at least I was smart enough to know that I had everything on the table. That in a career sense, professionally, every chip I had was on the table. Which is to say that if I was wrong on one story, if I was wrong about Watergate, I was through.
The danger in this whole thing was his constant telling lies. He's going to fix it next week. He's going to fix it next week. And he never fixed it. And one appearance on a television show by that man saying, look, American people, I'm sorry. I goofed. This is what happened, and it's my fault. That would have ended the whole thing.
In all of my years of public life, I have never obstructed justice. And I think, too, that I can say that in my years of public life, that I welcome this kind of examination because people have got to know whether or not their president is a crook. Well, I'm not a crook. I've earned everything I've got.
He dishonored himself and he dishonored the presidency by lying. And I think all of us involved, all of us who went to prison for long terms or short, would have understood it if Mr. Nixon had come forward and admitted his complicity to the extent that he was truthfully an accomplice or the generator of the activity. And then if we'd had to go to prison even then, that would have been okay.
I'm probably the only guy in America who's grateful for Watergate.
What's that?
I'm really glad Watergate
happened. Let me take it again. You are grateful for Watergate?
Absolutely. Watergate caused me to take a real hard look at what was important in my life. And I used to think the most important thing in the world was to get a call saying the President of the United States wants to see you, or the President's on the phone, or the White House operator at 2 o'clock in the morning would say, Mr. Colson, the president's calling you. I now realize that what really changes things, Henry Kissinger used to come into our 8 o'clock staff meetings every morning and say, Mr. President, the decision we make today is going to change the whole future course of human history. I look back on that and realize that we were caught up with pride and power and how we would maneuver against the Washington Post or how we'd engineer something against the Congress. I don't think the great forces of history are shaped by what happens at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. I've come to realize that what happens in the human heart is important. And one of the interesting footnotes of history, I suppose, is why I went to prison. I went to prison because you interviewed me, Mike, and in the course of a 60-minute interview, you asked me how I could be a Christian and still defend the kinds of things that Richard Nixon did and said in the White House that were then being disclosed on the tapes.
We were sitting in the playroom of Senator Harold Hughes.
Senator Harold Hughes, Democratic senator from Iowa. I called up my lawyer the night after I did the broadcast with you and 60 Minutes and said, David, I want to plead guilty. And he said, you're crazy. And that next week, we negotiated with the Watergate prosecutors. I told them what I had done, and we did not plea bargain for a light sentence. I told them I wanted the sentence determined by the court, and that was it. I went to prison.
The lessons of Watergate are just, I guess, go into government and understand what the government rests upon, which are clear constitutional principles of limited power. Take it seriously, and when you're asked or feel that you're impelled to try to do something beyond that, don't do it.
The sad residue of Watergate was so many people saw that their president had lied for 15 months and saw it so vividly and directly that a basic cynicism started in this country that has deepened, and deepened in a way where I think when you see things out of Washington these days, I know I live in Arizona, I don't believe anything that comes out of Washington. It seems to me that both political parties are in some kind of conspiracy for some reason not to tell us the truth.
The lesson that history is you never win the battle of freedom by one battle. You got to keep fighting. You got to keep ever vigilant. It's like cleaning the kitchen of roaches. You know, you can spray once and they'll be done for a while, but the damn roaches come back again, similar to the corrupt politicians. You got to keep spraying. And that's the lesson, that you can't rely on the system working once. You got to keep making it work. And it takes courageous congressmen, courageous press, and courageous people to hold as high a person as the president accountable.
The best lesson in an episode that was so full of ironies and odd, strange, moving, exciting, dismal transactions. But I found it very moving, and it went really to the heart of the problem that Richard Nixon had. And it's fair to say that in the manner of his departure from the presidency, he performed a signal service when he said to the gathered troops,
always give your best, never get discouraged, always remember, others may hate you, but those who hate you don't win unless you hate them, and then you destroy yourself.
That was an insight that Nixon shared with the country, and that in a way since then, he has largely lifted that incubus of hatred being out of politics.
But he was himself a president who hated.
He was, and he knew it, and that's why he said that. And that was one of the most eloquent pieces of presidential prose in the history of the American presidency.
What we started to have a comprehension of in those last weeks was Richard Nixon as a human. I think the country, as well as ourselves, started to see more of Richard Nixon as a human being in those weeks than we had seen in the previous 30-whatever years. So it was impossible not to have some feelings for, you know, this hadn't happened to any man in the history of the country.
President Nixon accomplished some good things as president, and I think history will note those good things. I think the opening to China simply reminds us of what potential for greatness Richard Nixon had. And I think history will record the good things that Richard Nixon did. But Richard Nixon himself has said that he let down the American people, and that he will always have to answer for that.
Watch News 7 tonight at 11, and here's what you'll see.
Kenneth Seguin, now charged with killing his two children and his wife. Prosecutors say it's a classic case of domestic abuse. And a sneak peek at what could be the summer box office winner, Batman Returns. News 7 is next.
You know, we hardly even advertise this stuff, and people are buying an awful lot of it. And what attracted you to it in the first place?
Well, Healthy Sensation attracted me right away, because the name is great, because it describes the dressing. My whole family love the taste.
They see these little things right here, these little bits?
Yeah. There's chopped parsley and an onion, and it tastes sensational.
So Healthy Sensation is a good name.
It's a great name.
It's a better name than if we'd called it, like, Ed. Healthy Sensation salad dressing. The name says it all.
Of all the things around your house that need batteries, there's one thing that needs a good, fresh battery most of all. See your Allstate agent for a free home fire safety brochure. And please check the battery in your smoke detector often.
There's never been a better time to tackle those big painting jobs. Because right now, Sears Easy Living Satin Finish Interior Paint is on sale. Only $13.99. Save $3 a gallon. And Easy Living means one coat coverage you can count on. Only at Sears.
If you've always wanted to get your hands on Batman, drop into McDonald's, where Batman Returns is on a dramatic series of 32-ounce collector cups with flying, crispy bat disc lids straight from the movie. You can pick up a large drink in one of six superhero collector cups at a special price when you buy any extra value meal. Because what you want is what you get at McDonald's today.
Simpson, do I smell waffles?
Mmm, delicious waffles, Jenkins.
I guess some of us care about our bodies and some don't.
Jenkins, I'm hurt. These are Eggo Nutri-Grain waffles made with nutritious whole grain.
Nutritious? You?
Absolutely. And no cholesterol, no sugar added, no preservatives.
I'm impressed. Do they taste as good as they smell?
There's only one way to find out.
If you insist.
Hey, let go of my Eggo.
Taste the wholesome goodness of Nutri-Grain waffles from Eggo.
At that point, I said, let's scratch it. And Liddy objected, let's go. Everybody's here, we got the team assembled. We've all come up from Miami. McCord's here, go. So they went, filed off into history.
All right, get over this way. All right, get over.
I'm running late, and I'm trying to get into a meeting, and I would appreciate it if you'd recognize the fact I have no comment this morning.
Well, before you go, can I just ask you this?
I'm not going to have any comments.
I do not think it's appropriate at this time for me to make any comment whatsoever.
Can we stop and chat with you for just a moment?
No.
Excuse me.
I'm not going to take any questions right now.
I might want to comment on individuals, and I wouldn't know the answer to your question to begin with.
How do you feel, Mr. Barker, to be out? How does it feel to be out, Mr. Barker?
Present at a meeting in February with Mr. Mitchell.
No statement.
They are the most beautiful ex-cops in the world and the most dangerous. Dangerous Herbs, later tonight on Crime Time After Prime Time. Thanks for making CBS America's most watched network. Now get ready for your local news. Then later, on most of these CBS stations, don't miss CBS News up to the minute.
But look, just like the Watergate reporting or any good reporting, God is in the details.
To order a video cassette collector's edition of Watergate, The Secret Story, call 1-800-453-7200. That's 1-800-453-7200. Call now. For a transcript of this program, send $8 to Burrell's Transcripts, Box 7, Livingston, New Jersey, 07039. Or call 1-800-777-TEXT.
All your money now!
Thursday.
Wednesday, a robbery at gunpoint leads an off-duty officer on a desperate chase. An all-new story on Top Cops. USA Today calls it a summer treat.
Adam, there's something I have to tell you.
Saying it's a garden of sexy delights.
Something I have to tell you first.
Then gives it 3.5 stars.
When does an affair actually begin?
Grapevine, the sassy new comedy for young lovers.
Is it the first time you kiss?
And the young at heart.
I said if she didn't put the money in my account, then I was leaving her.
I said goodbye and good luck.
It's hard to pull the plug on a marriage.
Not if there's a lot of money at stake.
Grapevine, right after Murphy Brown Monday.
She couldn't live without me.
One's a reluctant hero, the other's just reluctant.
Is this personal or is there cash involved?
But in searching for his lost son...
This is your secret weapon.
Darling, you're just seeing the outer band.
He needs all the help he can get.
Steve, get up here.
Don't you think this is something that you could kind of handle by yourself?
Jeffrey Meek, Lee Majors...
I'm living here in Hawaii with Robin Hood.
Coming next Wednesday, Raven.
You remember your high school prom? Some things never change.
Your senior prom should just be the most special night of high school.
Some things will never be the same.
Drugs, alcohol, guns, knives.
Make a date for prom night. It's a night they'll never forget. An all-new 48 Hours, 2 weeks from tonight.
This is CBS.
Hear tonight's winning lottery numbers drawn earlier this evening. Now stay tuned for News 7.